Crystal proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river, was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruit, and yielded her fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. That is our topic. God wants to heal the nations. Nations with an S. Amen. That is our ministry. Our ministry is all nations. In fact, it's a ministry for the whole church. The church universal should have an all nations mindset. Amen. It is totally wrong for churches to be totally cultural or ethnic. God never made it so. Amen. When God commissioned a church, he said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every single nation. Are you hearing this word? God wants us to be able to have the mindset that we will touch the four corners of this world. But God has a process. He will begin in your Jerusalem. Our Jerusalem is Durham, North Carolina. And when we take this land and we perfect the art of invading the kingdom of darkness and releasing the kingdom of God in the land, then he will release us to then begin to touch the Samaritans, to begin to fill up this land of Judea, North Carolina. Amen. 9.8 million people in this land. Amen. 100 counties. Blessed be his holy name. And then we touch the United States of America, going from state to state, planting trees all over the place. A tree being a church, a plant, one of the branches. Amen. Are you hearing this word? And then God began to send us to do crusades in different countries, in Mexico, in Colombia, in Asia, in Afghanistan, in Nigeria, in Ghana. Blessed be his holy name. God will send us all over the world. And it begins now. It begins right here. Blessed be his holy name. I mean, I think it's a privilege that God will call us to do something like this. This is our main purpose in life. When Jesus was leaving this earth, he gave a commission to the church. I want us to go to Matthew chapter 28. At times we quote these things and we lose the power in the verse. So I want us to really pay a little bit more attention to the words that Jesus used. You know, when somebody is dying, his final words are very critical. Is that not so? We don't joke with the dying man's wish. If he wants to eat beggar before he dies, we'll give him beggar. Calories and all. Hallelujah. It is his dying wish. Even somebody who's on the death row, they will say, what do you want to eat before he die? Amen. So the words of a dying man is very critical. Now, I'm not saying that God is dead, but he's leaving this earth space, going to sit at the right hand of God. So his last words are very critical. Matthew 28, verse 18, Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power, that word should have been authority, all power and authority is given unto me where? In heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all the black people. Teach all the white people. Teach only the Chinese. Teach only the Ashantis. Teach only the Igbos. Bible says you must teach what? All nations. That is what Jesus said. He says, go into all the world and do what? Teach all nations. Baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Bible says, teaching them, right, to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the earth. God is with those who have this mindset. God is not with those who have decided to, tailor their message to suit only their culture. Are you hearing this word? God wants us to be open-minded. Not liberal, but open-minded. Amen. To be able to minister to different cultures and different people. Can we hear a big amen? Amen. Hallelujah. But you see, it is interesting that Jesus came to his own. And his own received him not. But to them that received him, he gave them the power to become the sons of God. It doesn't mean that when you start this work, you'll be accepted. In fact, your own people may reject you. It's part of the plan. If you don't face rejection, you cannot receive people. In the ministry of Jesus and the ministry of Paul, they were initially rejected. And the rejection seemed to amplify their evangelism efforts. When Jesus was rejected in Nazareth, his hometown, they equalized his ministry and said, is he not the son of Joseph? Is he not the son of Mary? Are not his brothers with us and his two sisters with us? Who does he think he is? And over there, Jesus could not do much. He could not heal a lot of people. Blessed be his name. But the very same chapter, he went to Capernaum. Over there, they received him with open hands. And over there, whatever he said, they received it. And in that city, Capernaum, most of the miracles of Jesus were wrath. Because they received him. Amen. So the Bible says that if you receive the word, it will begin to have an effect in your life. As you go, and don't expect that people will accept you everywhere you go. But it is the rejection you go to that will open the door to greater nations. So Paul deliberately went to the very people who rejected him. He always would tailor his ministry first to the Jews. He said that the gospel of the message, I'm not ashamed of it. For it is the power of God to save first the Jews and then the Gentiles. So he will go to his own people, they will stone him, they will beat him up. They say, okay guys, since you don't like my message, I'm going somewhere else. Amen. And then there will be great success, the very next move. Hallelujah. Are you hearing this word? Rejection is the way to propel you into the purpose of God. Amen. If you be rejected somewhere, that means that somebody is waiting to accept you. Somebody's gain is somebody's loss. That's just the way it is. Are you getting this way? Hallelujah. Bible says go everywhere. Go everywhere. Go to the black. Go to the white. Go to the Asians. Hallelujah. Learn to eat their food. Hallelujah. I don't like this kind of food. Well, you better like it. Hallelujah. Alright, Mark 16, Mark chapter 16. We are just looking at the word, the last words of Jesus. Are you in this house? Say, I'm going everywhere. I am international. Brother, even in your business, you must be international. Amen. Everything you do, be international in your mindset. Alright, okay. Verse 15. Mark 16, verse 15. Are we in this house? He said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. You see this word? Every creature is the subject of your message. Amen. You are to open your life. For me, I don't like those people. God didn't say go to those you love. He said go to everyone. Amen. The apostles didn't want to do that. And God gave the job to Paul. And he did the job. Amen. Those who refuse to do this, they will see their mantles being removed and given to other people. The Bible says the one who was lazy, take the talent from him, give it to the one who did the most work. Hallelujah. Are you hearing this word? Let's move to Luke 24. Luke chapter 24. I'll be looking at 46 and 47. Bible says, and he said unto them, Luke 24 verse 46. Thus it is written, and thus it behoved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among. Are you being convinced? You need any more convincing after this? Hallelujah. Bible says you must take it. In Matthew he said it. In Mark, he said it. In Luke, he emphasized it. We are to take the word to every nation. In John, he begins to talk about having taken the word out, now begin to feed my lamb, begin to feed my sheep. The church comes into place after the kingdom of God has been manifested. Are you hearing this word? God wants us to go into all the world. But what has happened in the last few years is that churches have become kind of close-minded. We stay within our four walls. We get our choir in front of us. We put them some nice robes on their backs. The pastor preaches a nice, beautiful message. Hallelujah. We give our offering. Hallelujah. Amen. And then we go home. And then we gather again the next Sunday. Amen. And the next Sunday. Hallelujah. And the next Sunday. And there are souls who are dying out there. The church has to reorient itself. The church has to become the kind of church that God commissioned it to be. God wants us to go into all the world, and we are going to be doing that. Amen. Hallelujah. I believe the time has come for all nations, Restoration Fire Church, to fulfill its mandate. Amen. Wasn't it exciting on Friday night? Amen. And then Saturday. Amen. It was a good exercise, wasn't it? It was good to see Deacon Charles running around putting the signposts in the ground. I was like, my goodness. I saw the real soul running around and push somewhere, putting signs. I was like, yeah, this is what I'm doing something. I mean, when we went out to distribute the flyers, I said, Charles, are you coming? He says, Pastor, God has opened the door in this apartment. People are opening their hearts to us. We can't stop now. I hear this way. There was excitement in his voice. He said, Pastor, I came from work tired, but I feel charged. I feel revived. I feel fresh. Because when you're doing what God loves, he releases energy into your life. And God's favor begins to fall on you. And the spotlight of heaven is upon your life. When Philip took the message to Samaria, all of heaven began to concentrate the anointing on this one single man. But when he was pushing the agenda of God, whenever we push the agenda of God, God will reallocate resources to support that person. Amen. This is the will of God. This is the heart of God, to go out and reach all nations. And we are going to be doing that. We are going to be doing that. We are going to be doing that. Amen. Isn't it wonderful to see people coming out to receive Jesus Christ? A young man came yesterday and said, I want to change. Now, look, it's different when you invite people to come out. But when somebody is convicted in their own heart and says, I want to change, that one is different. You see, God will help us. God will help us. Say, God will help us. Hallelujah. As you go out, things begin to happen. There was a woman that had a child some time ago. And the doctor said that there's some hole in the heart or whatever. The woman went home and cried and cried and cried and cried and cried and cried. And finally they called. Hallelujah. He said, come and let's pray. We pray. I said, how can we find out that this hole in this baby is resolved? It's actually tomorrow. I have an ultrasound. I said, this is awesome. Go. So the next day, I said, Madam, what happened? He said, Pastor, they say everything is fine. Amen. There's no hole over there. Amen. I'm like, you know what? We should have gotten some documentation, some before and after pictures. Because sometimes when you say this, who will believe you? Yeah. Amen. But it is what it is. Amen. God knows what happened. Amen. And now the doctor said that, oh, there's something else. I said, no, they are ashamed and embarrassed. That's why they're doing that. Hallelujah. Yeah. God is so powerful. There is nothing he can do. There is no sickness he can heal. There is no bone he can reset. Amen. God is here in this house. And is going to commission this church to take the word out there. This is not a normal church. Let me calm down a little bit. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. We are not a normal church. Amen. We come and we just sit down and hear the word. You're full. But believe with the word of God. And then we go home. Belch. Yeah. You know, we just belch. Amen. We have to go and exercise the word out in the byways and in the highways. Are you hearing the word of God? This is when you begin to see God touching your life. This is when you begin to see God providing with special protection. This is when you begin to see God providing for you in a special way. This is when your deliverances are assured. Because now you are doing the word of God, God will begin to support you. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Blessed be his holy name. God is going to do more with you than you have ever imagined. It begins now. Say, it begins now. Healing for all the nations. Ever since the Bible began, healing has been given to all nations. Today, I want us to upgrade our level of belief from believing God for individuals to be healed. And families to be healed. To believe in God that a whole city can be healed. Amen. To believe in God that an entire hospital can be emptied out. Amen. Today I want to preach to you and tell you that God can heal the entire land. Amen. He says that in heaven there's a river that flows that can heal all nations. Amen. Amen. In fact, the people of Israel had no idea that this man in their midst, Elijah, could do so much work, could multiply bread. They allowed this prophet to go all the way to Zarephath to take care of one widow. But there were many widows in Israel. Blessed be his holy name. All the lepers in Israel, none of them were healed, but only one dude who came from Syria. Are you hearing this word? There's so much anointing in you. And the anointing is from heaven. The same rivers that flow in heaven flows within you. And those same rivers, if they can heal all nations and they are in you, you have the capacity, you have the potential to heal all nations. I want to hear a big amen. Amen. I say I can heal all nations. Philip went and healed all Samaria. One man. He didn't have a second guy with him. Amen. We were taught growing up that if you go and witness, you go with somebody. Amen. If you're going to witness to a woman, you let the man speak. That's how we were taught. Because women will gravitate more towards the men. If it's a woman, let the man speak. How many went to those classes? Amen. So Peter and John were always seen moving together. Philip went alone. By force. He was compelled to do that. But look at what God did with him. All of Samaria, the Bible says the city was filled with joy because of one man. Because there was a spell over that city. That one man went there and broke that spell. And the whole city began to rejoice. All dawn shall be saved. This whole land shall rejoice. I want you to believe God that God, if you can heal a person, you can heal a nation. Are you believing this? Do you know that God healed the whole nation of Israel when they were coming out of Egypt? In Psalm 105, verse 37, the Bible says that he led them forth with silver and gold. And there was not one feeble person amongst them. Not a single person in the Israelite camp was sick. Can you believe that? Every person was healed. May God do that in our life today. Amen. All throughout their walk in the wilderness, when they began to disobey God, then sicknesses came back into the camp. There was one time they were complaining against Moses. And they suddenly saw snakes biting them and killing them as a punishment from God. They went to Moses and said, Moses, we are sorry. We have realized that we've made a mistake. We will not say anything bad against you. Can you quickly please forgive us and quickly pray to God for us? Please don't take too much time to forgive us. Forgive us quick. See, but Moses was very meek. He forgave them on the spot. And he went to God and said, Father, how can we help these people? As he was praying, God said, now, take a bronze thing and make a snake out of it and put it on the tree. Any person that looks at this tree will amend. The Bible says, when he did that, and put a brazen serpent on the pole, every person that looked at the snake began to heal. Every person that looked at that pole healed. This is Old Testament. And the Bible says that a greater than Moses is here. A greater than Moses is here. Blessed be his name. The Father has always healed lots of people. The first healing session, first healing crusade was in the house of Abimelech. Guy made a very big mistake and took the wife of Abraham. Amen. That's very bad to be taking wives of prophets. Dangerous. Dangerous, dangerous, dangerous. Because God visited Abimelech and said, Abimelech, you gotta die. And I'm here to kill you. You know God kills, right? They think only the devil kills. God, he said, I'm going to come to kill you. He says, what have I done? He says, you are with the wife of my prophets. He said, he said that she is my sister. And in the innocency of my heart, and in the integrity of my heart, I have done this. God says, yeah, I realize that you were innocent, and then, but I'm still going to have to kill you unless you restore the woman to the man. And God said, yes, sir. They said, Abraham, what in the world? You got me into trouble. You got all of us into trouble. Amen. God says, because of the innocency of your hands and integrity of your heart, I kept you from sleeping with that woman. And that whole house had been afflicted with diseases because of Sarah. Amen. So when he called Abraham and said, Abraham, I am sorry. You lie, but I think that doesn't help you. So you get some money. Get some stuff as, you know, a gift for the inconvenience that I put you through. And could you please pray for us? Abraham said, thank you very much. Hallelujah. Isn't it good to be a prophet of God? See, God loves you so much that when you become committed to him, even when you mess up, he will still stand for you. Amen. Amen. Somebody can come to you and say that, you know what your son was doing? Say, shut up. He hasn't done anything. Get away from him. That's your son. Then you go and say, hey, my son, what in the world are you trying to do? That's That's how God is. When the enemy comes against you and begins to show off your filth, like in Zechariah 3, this high priest stood before God in filthy clothes, and Satan was accusing him, and the Lord said, "The Lord rebuke you. Get thee out of here." And he took care of Master Joshua, the high priest, and took off his dirty clothes and gave him new clothes. Our God is so good, so kind. He's your friend. Say, "He's my friend." See, a friend loves at all times. A friend will not stop loving you when the going gets rough. There are some people, they are called fair weather friends. God is not a fair weather friend. When you are good, he loves you. When you are bad, he still loves you. But if you die being bad, you may end up in the wrong side of eternity. So whilst you are alive, get your life straight with God. Can I hear a big amen? Amen. Hallelujah. God wants to heal all of us. He healed all of them. Blessed be his name. See, God wants to heal this land of Durham, North Carolina. And we have to do that by doing healing campaigns. Shout, healing campaigns. You know, Abimelech, as I was saying, he and his wife and his children, I mean, all the women in his house had plagues. And they could not give birth. That means Sarah was in his house for a long time. When Abraham prayed to God, and the Bible says, all the women in the house were healed. So Abraham was a healer. Abraham, our father, he started this whole process. He healed an entire nation. All the women in that house, the Bible says they began to give birth after he prayed. That means that until he prayed, they couldn't give birth. Isn't this wonderful? That when we begin to pray, people's knees are healed. When we begin to pray, people's ears open, people's eyes open, the leg begin to walk. God has placed and deposited something powerful in your life. And I want you to believe that God will use it. Amen. If your son is sick, before you call the hospital, please, please, please use the anointing in your hands. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Many of us, we have, instead of by his stripes we are healed, we have UNC Hospital 911. Amen. Jesus Christ has taken away all our infirmities. Instead of that, you have UNC Hospital. As soon as somebody calls, hey, let's call urgent care. That is not God's way. God says, is any among you sick? Let him call. For the let him what? Call. What do they put by those phone calls? Call. And God says, call the elders first. Amen. So on our website, we have the list of elders who are the healers in this house. So you can go to our website and call them. And they have to come. If they don't come, call me. Amen. Hallelujah. But call them first. Isn't God awesome? It says, call the elders of the church. And when they come, let them come with oil. Amen. Somebody came to me recently and said that, oh, my destiny is sick. I said, okay, I'm coming with the oil. He says, no, 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 no. People don't understand this. When you are sick, call for the elders of the church. They come with what? Oil. And let them anoint that person with oil and pray a certain kind of prayer. Don't go and stand over the place and say, Father, if you will, if it is possible, we ask you by your tenderness, your benevolent goodness, that you will move your hand and touch this person. But if it is not your will, we commit him into your hands. We know that it's not, we don't have to grieve when we die. That prayer will send a guy off to the grave real quick. That kind of prayer will kill somebody. Hallelujah. God says when you go pray the prayer of faith. The prayer of faith means that you know what you are praying about. The Bible says that faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. You say in the name of Jesus. Father, your word says in Psalm 53 that by his stripes we are healed. Thank you for your word in Psalm 103 that says, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all our iniquities, who healeth all our diseases. Are you here this way? He said, Father, please let me add one more witness. In 1 Peter 2, verse 24, your word says, who his own self bear our sins in his own body on the tree, so that we, having died to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes we were. Father, let me add one more one just to me. At this time, the guys like I'm feeling the fire of God all over their body. Father, in Matthew 8, he said, Himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Four scriptures have been released. So, Father, on the basis of these scriptures, I claim healing for my sister. And I decree to you, my sister, you are healed. Hallelujah. And the same way, and the same prayer that heals also forgives. He says, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick. And if you have committed sins. So the same prayer that heals also forgives. It's powerful. It's so powerful that your prayer can actually forgive and heal at the same time. Hallelujah. Jesus said that to that young man who was paralyzed and they broke the roof. He said, young man, your sins are forgiven. The boy was having some hiccup over that. He says, let me show you that I can forgive this guy. Young man, arise, go home. Dude got up, rolled up his bed, walked home. Before all of them. He said, my God, today we have seen strange things today. Are you hearing this word? Say, Father, when I lay hands on my brother, on my sister, on my son, on my daughter, on my husband, on my wife, let the healing power of God touch that person and heal them in Jesus' name. Father, my colleague at work, when he coughs, when I put my hand on him, let that cough evaporate. God wants you to be healing people. The healing is in your hands. It says, if you believe. In Mark 16, you all read that scripture, right? It said that those that believe, when they go out to preach in my name, they will cast out devils. They will heal the sick. They will lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. God says that if you lay hands on the sick, they will recover. Are you hearing this word? So when Jesus came, he healed people individually. But he also did healing campaigns. Go to Matthew 14. Healing campaigns. Father, let's go to Luke 4 first. Luke chapter 4. Hallelujah. Do you know God is going to lift you up to do a healing campaign? And it's not anything difficult. It's a matter of believing that when you pray, God will honor that word. Amen. Many people are scared to pray for the sick. In fact, many ministers don't pray for the sick. Find the praise that God healed you in Jesus' name. And you leave it at that. Because they don't want to ask you, are you well? Because if the person says, I'm not well, then you get embarrassed. That is a big mistake. The Bible says, if you ask the Father anything in my name, Paul Adam will do it. I don't see Paul Adam in the Bible. It says, I, who is the I? Jesus Christ will do it. So it's not even dependent on you. So we are just checking to see what Jesus just did. And can Jesus fail? It will never fail. Hallelujah. You must have faith. You must have faith. I believe God is training you this morning. Amen. Luke chapter 4. Hallelujah. Jesus did a healing campaign in Capernaum. Amen. Verse 38. Say individuals, communities. So God has commissioned you to heal individuals and also to heal communities. If you are a caterer, amen, and you can cook for your family, then you should be able to cook for a whole school. Is that true or not? Is that true or false? If you can cook for one person, you can cook for a whole school. If you can heal one person, you can heal a whole community. Blessed in his name. Begin to believe God, that Father, you will use me. You will send me to this nation of Korea. You will send me to this nation of Mexico. You will send me all the way to Timbuktu, whatever, wherever it is. That in Mali or something. Timbuktu. Why do they keep using us in Timbuktu? Amen. We'll go to Madagascar. Amen. And I will heal that whole state on my own. Hallelujah. They went everywhere and preached the gospel. The Lord working with them and confirming the way with signs following. God will confirm the way. If you go, he will confirm the way. Hallelujah. In Luke chapter 4, verse 38, can we read the scripture together? He arose out of the synagogue, entered into Simon's house, and Simon's wife's mother was taken with a great fever, and they besought him for her. And he stood over her, and what did he do? He rebuked. Now, do you rebuke a condition? It's a person. That thing is a person, it's a spirit. He says, get out of here in Jesus' name. He didn't have to use the name of Jesus, but he is Jesus. Amen. Bible says he stood over her and rebuked the fever, and it. And she arose after 10 days. Okay, she arose the next day. When did she arise? Immediately. So that is why when you come and say, are you healed? Are you fine now? Check. Is there any pain there? Why? Because we believe that when the boy says immediately, we should also expect the same result here. Of course, there are those situations where you amend after some time. But check out those verses carefully where they began to amend. In almost all those cases, they were a distance away. The lepers, as they were going, they were what? Cleansed. The same day, the young man who came to Jesus Christ in John 4, he says, please come home and pray for my son. Jesus said, if I don't do signs, you won't believe. Go, your son liveth. Bible says when he got home, he said, oh, your son is fine. He says, really? He says, when? He says, yesterday, around the hour of 7, he began to amend. He began to recover. Amen. Bible says this guy from the day, he said, the man realized that it was the same hour that Jesus said, your son liveth. So the sickness left him, but he was just recovering. But if he was close to Jesus, Jesus would say, behold. That means even strength should come into your body now. Are you hearing this word? So if the person was close to Jesus, it was immediate. So those verses they always use to say they recover is usually when it's a distance. Somebody comes and stands in the gap for a mother, a brother or sister. We send the word. It travels there at the speed of light and the person is healed. Are you believing this word? Hallelujah. Immediately. She arose. Hallelujah. How will Mark say? Mark will say straightway. Hallelujah. Straightway. I love the straightway. Mark loves straightways. Hallelujah. Immediately she arose. This woman who was seized with a great fever was moving quickly, putting the onions in the thing, and also opening the oven, and also throwing the thing into the fire, and doing this. This one was going to take a while of them, and she did. Hallelujah. May God raise us up to set people free. Amen. It did not end there. Verse 40 is powerful. Verse 40, can we get there? And now when the sun was setting, all they that had any sick with diverse or various ailments brought them unto him. And he laid his hands on some of them. All of you are healed. He laid his hands one by one. That's a long night. They lined up. Then you lay hands. Come. Lay hands. Come. Lay hands. Come. Lay hands. You two come. Lay hands. Every single one of them. Why has the church stopped doing that? I think it's laziness. I call that spiritual laziness. Our hands are so, I don't know what word to use. So precious. We don't touch them. Put the hands. You are healed in Jesus' name. Amen. Now I believe that the word of God can heal the sick. And we do that. But if someone is not healed, let them come and lay hands on them. Are you hearing this word? Let us believe that God, what he did, we can do the same thing. Some people, they have so much faith and they are so deep in the word, they understand the healing move. So when you say you are healed, they receive the word, they are healed immediately. Some people have no idea, they're like, you gotta touch me first. Look at how Naaman was struggling. Go and dip yourself in the River Jordan. He says, what in the world? I'm expecting this dude to come out. Is he on a prophet? No, come and strike the place. Strike the place. Strike the leprosy. Are you kidding me? Put my hands on the leprosy. What are you talking about? He says, come and strike the place. And say a few words, you know, all kinds of kibikib, no. And then, you know, I'll be fine. The servant said, okay. If he told you to do something big, you would have done it. He said, go and have a bath. We've been traveling from Syria. You are sweating. This is a good time to bath. So let's go and then dip yourself seven times and we'll be fine. Naaman is persuaded. He goes in, he bows seven times and the leprosy, go on. Are you hearing this word? So you know, the point of contact varies, but the main point of contact is the hand. Amen. So when you lay hands on people, they begin to believe. At times, people are standing in front of me, I can see unbelief. So that means they have to pray very well. So I pray the kind of prayer that will convince the person that God is moving for them. Not me. I'm already convinced that you can be healed. I'm teaching you something. When somebody comes with unbelief, there's a way to break the unbelief down. Begin to go into your deepest prayer. Amen. By the time you have done prayer, after 2 minutes, the person is open up to you. It's one nice way to do it. Father, you will heal this woman in the name of Jesus. This woman will not go back the same way. Because she has come here, she will be healed.
Amen.
Therefore, you will have to take your hands off. Even if there's no devil. Therefore, you will take your hands off in the name. The woman is getting very convinced. It's like, uh-huh. The hands begin to go up. Before you are aware, the woman is healed. Are you healed? Yes. Amen. Why? Because you have to gauge. Doctors vary their medicines according to what they see. Are you getting what I'm saying? With some people, you see the faith, ah, you are healed, madam, you are healed. Oh, fine. Hallelujah. Praise God. There's a wonderful story I heard a long time ago. I think the Redeemed Church. There was an old woman who was very sick. Amen. And the sons were like worried about her. And she told them, just get me to the church. Take me to one of the pillars and I'll be fine. He said, Mama, are you sure about this? He says, yeah, that's what I want to do. So they bundled this woman up, took her to the place. She finds a way to one of the pillars of the church, wraps her hands around it, she gets healed. Can you imagine that? That was her faith.
Amen.
A woman said, no, I don't need this man to touch me. All I need to do is touch the hem of his garment. That's all. So she works her way through the crowd, touches the hem, she gets healed and runs away. They say, hey, madam, come. Tell your story. Are you hearing this way? People have so much faith that they don't need too much work on your behalf. Even if the centurion said, don't come to my house. I'm a man under authority and I have people under me. I say to this guy, go, he goes. I say, come, he comes. I tell my servant, do this, he does it. So you just have to issue commands and my servant will be fine. She said, wow, I never saw this much faith. First, Jesus said, I will come and heal him. So when he saw the level of faith, he said, ah, I've been saved the trip. Praise God, you are healed. Your son is fine. And the son or the servant got healed that very hour. You have to learn how to discern the level of faith of those who come to you. And let me give you one big secret. Many preachers preach that you must have faith before you can be healed. That is true. You must have faith before you can be healed. But for somebody to walk out of their chair and walk all the way to the front, there is some faith there. Otherwise, they will sit there and insult you in their head. Amen. But if they have gone out of their chair and walked all the way to the front, they have some faith. The Bible says, if your faith is as small as a mustard seed, that's all God needs to work with. He doesn't need a mountain faith. He said, just give me a little bit. You can move a mountain with just a little bit of faith. Are you hearing this word? The Bible says he laid hands on every one of them and ministered to them. Therapy. The word heal them is therapy. Shout therapy. You know, in this church, you will learn some Greek. Amen. But therapy is English, right? Therapy means to minister. To do something to the person. To minister as a servant. So Jesus was laying hands and tending to them. Isn't Jesus wonderful? Yeah. Ministering to these ones. Amen. May God touch our lives. May God remove impatience out of our lives and begin to slow down and see people being healed. Amen. When somebody is healed in their body, they will open up their hearts to all that else God wants to do in their life. Hallelujah. That was a powerful move. Let's go to chapter 5. Luke chapter 5. Healing campaign, shout healing campaign.
Healing campaign.
Luke chapter 5, Hallelujah. Are we all there? Verse 12. Again, you see individual and then multitude. I want you to get this concept this morning. The Bible says, it came to pass, verse 12, when he was in a certain city, a certain man, full of, this guy is in the latter stages of the leprosy, or HIV full blown, he's about to die. Bible says, who seen Jesus, fell on his face, and besought him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. That means if you are willing. Now this should solve that question. Is Jesus willing to heal us? Well, what did Jesus say in the next one? And he put forth his hand. And did what? Elijah said, go to the river. Jesus touched the leper. Do you know what it means to touch a leper? Ha! The thing can fall on you. Remember when the first time when AIDS came? If somebody had AIDS, they would lock that person in the room somewhere. When he talks, people will go and check themselves whether they have HIV. Amen. Yeah. Jesus touched this person. That is compassion. Compassion will make you do those kinds of things. Amen. And he touched him, saying, I will. Shout, I will. Walk to somebody and say, I will.
I will.
Get out of your seat and greet someone and say that, I will. Jesus is willing to heal you. Tell that person, Jesus is willing to heal you. It is his will for you to be healed. I will. I will. I will. Hallelujah. Glory be to God in this place. So, let me ask you a question. If you go to somebody and begin to pray and say, Father, if it be thy will, is that a good prayer? That is a very bad prayer. That is not correct. Amen. Now you pray, if it be thy will, if you are trying to, you are consecrating yourself to God. Amen. You try to figure out what God wants you to do with your life. That is why you pray that prayer. But when it comes to healing, you already know the will of God. Once you know the will of God, it's over. Amen. He touched you saying, I will. Down clean, and the next day immediately shout immediately. I want to shout immediately. Say straightway. All the men should say straightway, and the men should say immediately. 1, 2, 3, straightway. Hallelujah. I want this to get into your bones that when you lay hands on somebody, straightway they should be healed. Immediately they should be healed. If Jesus did it, you can do it. Say, Jesus can, I can. Right? He said, the same works I do, you shall do. And greater works than this shall ye, not Paul alone, you can do, because I go to the Father. There's healing in your hands. It's there. It's already there. Is the Holy Ghost not in you? Yeah. Are you on the temple of the Holy Ghost? You can set people free. Amen. Bible says the leprosy packed his bags. Amen. Took his cell phone. Hallelujah. Took all his bags and then left. Today, anything that is clinging to your life, I command it to be loose from your body. I command it to be packed to the dry places right now in the name of the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. What verse are we in? Okay. People are all over the place. Some are in Walmart. Amen. Some are in Payless Shoes. Amen. Some are already buying stuff on Amazon and Commerce. We are here. We God bring our mind here. Amen. Bible says in verse 14, and he charged him to tell no man, but go and show thyself to the priest and offer for thy cleansing according as Moses commanded, for a testimony unto them. Now, if you read John, the Bible says many chief priests believed in Jesus. Let me ask you, how did they come to the point of believing that Jesus is powerful? The same people they have pronounced unclean were coming back to them totally clean. And you ask them, what happened? Oh, there's this young man from Galilee, says he's from Nazareth. He just prayed for me and I got healed. The very next day, another leper is there. And then 9 lepers came. Say, who is this Jesus? He says, guys, I need to go somewhere today. I also need my own help. Hallelujah. I have my mic here. Let me go and get this guy to heal me. Are you here this way? The chief priest began to believe. Because these guys were coming. Offer for your cleansing. Blessed be his name. Hallelujah. And the Bible says, verse 50. So there are some healings we don't broadcast. Amen. Now I will say that again. There are some healings God will not have you broadcast it. Amen. He has his own reasons. And there are some healings God will insist on the testimony coming out. Remember that guy, Jesus said, why is it that only this guy came? Where are the other nine? Why did they come and tell us what happened to them? He wasn't happy at all. He said, why is it only the Samaritan has come? He says, woman, where do you think I'm going? Come and tell us what happened to you. You go here and then you are walking away. But the other man, he says, don't tell anybody. But the leprous man went away and told everybody. Now Jesus couldn't enter the cities. Right? And he wanted to come into the city and heal the people and heal the city. But now he couldn't enter the city because everybody knew about him. God has to come to places incognito. Amen. And when he leaves, the whole place is on fire. That is how he operates. So if somebody announces him too much, it messes up that way. Now people have to move out of their cities. And they go heal on mountains and deserts. But the cities were full of devils. So when they went back home, things were still bad. Are you hearing this way? Because there are principalities over cities who legislate the kingdom of darkness. One time Jesus said to a young man, after he healed him, he said, don't go back into that city. It was a city called Bethsaida. Later he cursed that city because they didn't repent. But he prayed for them. Why? Because he had to go into those cities to bring those principalities down. I don't know whether I get this way. Anyway, that is a master's course right there. Now let's get back to bachelor's. Amen. Hallelujah. Where are we? 16. The Bible says, 15. But so much the more went there a fame abroad of him. And great multitude, shout multitudes. That means huge crowds. If you are prepared to pray for that one person, God will send you the multitudes. Amen. If you can't go to that one person's house because you are so big and so powerful, you can't go there yourself. God will not send the multitudes to you. You have to be able to take care of one person and then God will release the multitude to you. Blessed be his holy name. Bible says, great multitudes came. Number one, to do what? To hear and to be healed of their infirmities. Faith coming by. So when you want to see people being healed, when you go to somebody's room, person's lying there with a great fever. When people are sick, their faith level is almost non-existent. Are you aware? Amen. You see, you just can't believe anything. You've been lying there for 12 days. This thing has been knocking the brains out of you. You can't even believe anything. You don't go there and say that you are healed in Jesus' name. That's the way that way. You begin to go there, say, how are you doing, my brother? All is well. Is all is well? You don't know what I'm going through. I've got this pain in my leg. And the pain has also moved over here. And it's out of my chest. And now because I've lied in bed for so long, I have sores in my back. You don't know what I'm talking about. Just go get me some water to drink, if you would, please. He says, no, let me read a story from the Bible for you. You begin to talk about some healings that Jesus did. Hallelujah. You see the light coming back into the eyes of that person. You build up faith in the person. Amen. You begin to sing one or two songs, if need be. Amen. Now when the person's faith has risen to a certain level, boom, you begin to pray for that person. At that moment, you need to know when to strike. Amen. You don't strike when the iron is cold. Make sure that the environment is right. Jesus, when he went to that young girl who was dead, the environment was bad. People were crying all over the places. Get out, guys. Amen. And he took only 3 of his 12 disciples. This healing, he didn't want Judas Iscariot with him. He took only 3 guys. And the father and the mother. And the young girl came alive. Are you hearing this word? Make sure the atmosphere is fine. That is why at times we will sing songs and praise his name for a while before we begin to pray for people. So that they can come to the same point that you are at. Some faith must be released for the healing to manifest. If this doesn't happen, and the person gets healed on only your faith, as soon as you leave, the person will be in trouble. But when their faith is released and they believe, they can hold on to that thing when you lead them. Blessed be his holy name. Are you getting this word? Today is healing 202. Hallelujah. Blessed be his name. Hallelujah. They came to hear and to be healed. They came to what? Hear and to be healed. You must release a word, a person will get healed. Amen. At times, take one of the stories you like best and tell the person that story. You will see that person be in chapter 6. Verse 17. He came down with them and stood in a plain and the company of his disciples and a great multitude. You see this one? Not just a multitude, but what? A great one. Out of all Judea and Jerusalem and from the seacoast of Tyre and Sidon, which came to hear and to be. You see the process? Always give a word and then you can see the person being healed. Faith comes by what? Hearing. Hearing by the word of God. Amen. Amen. To hear and to be healed of their diseases. Verse 18 is glorious. And they that were vexed with unclean spirits and the evil spirits were cast out. Is that what the scripture says? And evil spirits cast out or they are healed. So here they were healed. That means that the healing anointing drives out devils. The healing anointing heals and also drives out devils. Amen. Isn't this wonderful? Verse 19, I want us all to read this. And the whole multitude sought to touch him, for there went virtue out of him. Heal some of them. Heal two of them. All of them got healed. God wants to heal the whole city. In this particular thing, you see how it moved from stages. It progressed. Where first he was laying hands, now they were laying hands on him. Can I teach you something here? If you exercise the little anointing you have, God will begin to give you more. Amen. So if you want more anointing, it's not just praying and fasting that will do it, but also exercising what you do have. Amen. As you just do what you know the best way you can, God will begin to assist you with more anointings. Now, in reach of power, the anointing was so palpable, so tangible. So, you could, that the whole atmosphere was impregnated with the power of God. They said, we just didn't touch you. Please let us just touch you. And as they touched him, evil spirits were driven out of their bodies. Their sick bodies were healed. May that be a portion today. I want you to believe God that God, if you can use me to touch an individual, use me to heal my whole neighborhood. Use me to heal my whole company. Heal me to heal my whole city. Father, in the fullness of time, send me off to cities. Let me see all of Egypt being healed. John Knox said, give me Scotland or I die. God gave him Scotland. God wants to give us cities. People are interested in taking over neighborhoods. I'm interested in taking over this city. God is giving us this city. Amen. It is inconvenient. Today our drums are not here, right? Because we have to carry it somewhere. My nice pulpit is not here today. Today this thing is moving along the line like that. Isn't it inconvenient? Amen. And then we have to go and feed everybody who comes. Amen. But why are we doing it? Because we feel that this city must be saved. Hallelujah. Amen. Yesterday during the conference, a man of God came. And he said what? That God has chosen us to lead this fight. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? I don't know whether you heard the man. Hallelujah. He said God has chosen us. How did God choose us? Because we stepped out there. You will see other men of God beginning to do this all over the place. You see churches beginning to do this. It will catch on. When we first came to Durham, we started praying and praying. Many churches were not praying. Before long, other churches started having Friday prayer meetings. Friday, everywhere you go, Friday prayer meeting. God is using us. Amen. Our beginning may seem, I like the word seem, but our end is going to be powerful. Amen. We're going to take over this whole city. Amen. In fact, I want a church. Everybody should buy a chair so that we can get some more chairs. Amen. Operation, buy a chair. So next week, everybody come with $35. Buy a chair. Tell the person to buy a chair. This is just $35. So please, when you come, don't mess with your tithes. Tithes is separate. Offerings is separate. This one is donation. You write a check, $35, my chair. You write in the memo line, my chair. Are you hearing this way? Within 2 weeks, we'll have the chairs over there. God was going to blow us up. Yeah, God will help those who push his agenda. As you are pushing the agenda of God, be ready for something to happen in this city. We will begin to experience overflow crowds. People have to be in your other house and they will have to beam everything to them, live streaming to them. And to finally, someone will come and say, Pastor, what is this? I give you, this building is yours. Go and take it. Are you believing this? I don't know how God has been to doubt in Thomas's here or what. God is going to do whether you believe it or not. Many have seen dreams. Many come to me, Pastor, I've seen this house full. I've seen us breaking into this place. I've seen us with canopies out there. One person came and said, we have canopies outside. God is doing something. And you are part of it. Blessed be his name. Can we stand on our feet? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Say, Father,
Father,
I accept my commission
to be an agent
of health to the whole city that you have planted me in. I believe that when I lay hands on the sick, they will be healed. I believe that if that person has sinned, when I pray for that person, that iniquity will go away. That sin will be removed. I believe that when I lay hands, devils will go out. Devils will not stay. They will have to leave. I thank you, Father, that there's a power at work within me, that when I ask for something in prayer, you are able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above what I can think of or imagine. Father, let me be so. When I lay hands on the sick, let them be instantaneous healers in the name of Jesus. Lay your hands on your own head and say, Father, any sickness in my body, as I lay hands on myself, let that sickness go. Any sickness that is yet to manifest, I speak to you prophetically. You will not manifest. I diffuse you. I dismantle you out of my body now. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let us hold hands and say, I am a tree of life. My tongue is a tree of life. My tongue is an ambassador of health. When I speak, life will come out. Life will come to people. In Jesus' name, I am a healer. Because God has made me so. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, as your steward in this house, I release healing gifts in this house. In the name of Jesus, I activate the spiritual gifts of healings in the lives of the saints. I release the spiritual gift of faith in this house. I release the spiritual gifts of the working of miracles in this house. I activate these anointings. I command these gifts to be manifest when the people of God step out in faith and say, where is that God of Elijah? Father, that you perform the counsel of your messengers in the name of Jesus. Yes, Lord. If you are in this house and you've ever dreamt or had the vision of yourself praying for somebody to be healed, praying for somebody to be delivered, you know, ministering to the sick, ministering to someone who is bound, you have seen yourself setting other people free, I want you to come out and we'll just activate that anointing in your life. In the name of, you have dreamt or you've had a vision where you see yourself praying for somebody, setting somebody free. God is calling you into a certain ministry of the healer. Amen. The Bible says in Luke 9 verse 1, the Bible says that Jesus called the 12 unto him. Luke 9 verse 1, and he gave them He gave them what? Power and authority. Luke 9, verse 1. Hallelujah. Luke 9, verse 1. Are you there? All right. He called his 12 disciples together and he did what? Gave them power and authority over all devils and to do what? Cure diseases. What I'm doing this morning is I'm releasing that authority. I'm releasing that power. God has already spoken to you. Amen. And I want you to believe that after this prayer, you have received a mantle. And as you go out, when you pray for people, they will be healed. You will see them healed instantaneously. Amen. I want you to believe God. Amen. Give me some oil. Amen. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. God, we honor you. Father, I'm obeying your word. I'm not doing anything by myself. I thank you that you asked for this to be done. Father, as I activate and stand up what is already in there, Lord, grant your people boldness to step out. And as they step out, yes, Lord, may your healing angels be with them. Father, as I stand here, I'm standing before your throne. And Father, I make a requisition for healing angels to be assigned to each of these ones. Father, release the angels of healing to these ones. When they step out in faith, may those angels begin to perform every word they speak. Jesus, when they pray, move on their behalf. Do that which they can do in Jesus' name. Receive power and receive authority over all devils to cast them out. Receive power to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Put Matthew 10 verse 1 to Matthew 10 verse 1. God is releasing power and authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. I feel that the Father is telling me that you have special giftings, especially in dealing with mental problems. My dear brother, I believe the Father is telling me to tell you that somebody with mental problems, ADT, autism, mental issues, God is giving you a special grace to deal with those people. Amen. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? You work as a behavior specialist. Can you believe that? God is a God of miracles. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Amen. It is so. It is so.
Praise the Lord. Jesus, you are powerful. My wife and I just moved here from Philadelphia. 3 weeks. The first week, we didn't go to church. I wasn't moved. And I asked the Lord to send me into a church, a believing church, an international church of all nations. And last week, my wife went to another church. I wasn't moved. As the head of the home, we were watching TV yesterday, and the Spirit of God just pointed this church to us, and we came to visit the people. In Philadelphia, I work as a behavioral specialist with individuals with mental disabilities. This is the true message from God.
It's going to be powerful. God is powerful. Father, I release this answer. When he lays hands, Father, mental diseases will go. Psychomatic diseases will leave. Father, psychological issues will go. Father, as he believes and as he lays hands, he will see people coming out of his wards, totally healed in Jesus' name. I release power and authority over the deaf and dumb spirits. Father, when he rebukes, they will go. Father, autism will leave. ADT will leave. Behavioral problems will leave. In Jesus' mighty name. It is so. It is so, my brother. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you for that testimony. Father, I release deliverance anointing upon your son. You have revealed your son several times how he is delivering people. Father, you will empower him to cast out devils. Father, you grant me special anointing to discern evil spirits and to cast them out. I release this grace upon his life, that those who are possessed, those who are oppressed, Father, those who are being tormented by devils, your son will set them free by the power of the Holy Ghost. I activate this gift. Call the working of miracles in your life in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are a healer. You are a healer. You are a healer. You are a healer. There is healing in your voice. The main manifestation of your gift will be through your voice. As you speak, people will be healed. When people hear what you are saying, they will be healed by you just speaking. I release that imperial anointing upon your life. I stir up this grace of the healer in your life. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, it is so. In the name of Jesus, Father, I bless your handmaiden right now. I bless her in Jesus' name. I bless your handmaiden in Jesus' name. I activate every virtue in her life. Every virtue in her life, yes, Lord. Father, I release that grace upon her life, even to heal people who are beyond help. People in the terminal care. People who are on the last leg. People have been given days and months to live. People have been told that you have just 6 months to live. She will be able to see them coming out of that. Hallelujah. Father, thank you for the gift of faith that you're releasing upon her life. I release this unction. I stir up this grace in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Father, thank you for your son. I release this oil upon his life, Lord. When he will lay hands on the sick, they shall recover. Father, from today henceforth, I release instantaneous, immediate, notable miracles. Yes. See who gets out of wheelchairs. See who gets out of wheelchairs. I release this grace upon your life. People come in wheelchairs and they will walk out on their own feet. Knee replacement specialists. I release this grace upon your life. Any knee problem you see, go for it. You are a knee replacement specialist. You will set people free out of wheelchairs in the mighty name of Jesus. I release. Hallelujah. I thank you, Father, for the spirit of boldness. Thank you for that boldness upon your son. Thank you, Father, that you set him apart from the womb for this work. Thank you that you have trained him through all these years to step into this. Yes, Lord. I release this mantle upon his life. Thank you so much. There's a great angel that has been released to you. It's like this, like, you know, with this mantle. My brother, a mantle has come on your life. Because of what you have been doing for God, there's a mantle that has been released upon your life. I loose this mantle upon your son right now. May it envelop him. May it fall upon his shoulders. When he steps out there, may your Holy Ghost speak through him the words of life that will bring conviction to communities all over the world. Father, you will use him to spread the kingdom of God. Kingdom glory. Brother, yours is not just a gift or an anointing. It is an ambassadorial grace to release the kingdom of God everywhere you go. And loose this grace upon your son in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Glory. Who is coming? Father, I thank you for your son. Yes, Lord. He's a deliverer. He's a savior. He's a judge. Thank you for what you have caused him to experience. At times our experiences helps us to be better prepared to help others. Father, you are not going to release him with sharp eyes. The eye of the prophets. Father, the eye of the eagle to see, hallelujah, into even people's bodies. You can see the affliction and be able to address those issues. It's a prophetic mantle. It's a prophetic mantle. It is a prophetic mantle. Hallelujah. It's a prophetic mantle. I lose it upon your life in the name of Jesus. I release the spirit of counsel upon your life. Hallelujah. Jesus said to that man, go to the pool of Siloam When the guy came, he was seeing. God is giving you that gift where yours is not just to lay hands, but to tell people what they have to do. And when they do what you tell them, they will come to pass. Father, I release this unction. I release this grace. I stand up this grace upon her life. May the spirit of counsel fall heavily upon her life. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Father, help me to remember. Oh, glory be to God. Amen. Mr. Morgan, do you know you are a heavily anointed man?
Hallelujah.
You may not know it, but you are. There's a grace on your life for multitudes. See, there are some people who have a grace to pull crowds. That grace is on his life. It's been there for a long time, but today you have been caught. Today God is tearing up that gate. It's a gate for crowds. Am I telling the truth?
Yeah, it's true. The reason why I come out is the whole last week when I was working, you know, it's not in the night, it's daytime, I'm working. But I see my back home, my hometown, some old, those people died some years. And it's like, I organized some crusade, and I was telling them why this man was doing this, but, you know, some people had destroyed their things. And it's like the chief too back home was doing some things which was very bad. Then I go there, I see that I just walk there and I say, in the name of Jesus, all the people's, you know, I'm doing some things like that. I say, what am I doing? For the whole week, it's continuing. And I see some number keeping calling my phone. I know number, if I don't say your name, I don't keep the call. So this morning, the same number was keep, you know, ringing. That's what it is. When I pick, it's my sister. I said, what's wrong? I said, ma'am, sick. I said, ma'am, sick for what? I said, okay, where is she? I said, she's sick. I said, put your hand on her. So I put your hand on her. I said, in the name of Jesus, my girl, all the demons working with you, in the name of Jesus, I'm cursing them. They shouting. I said, what is that? I'm shouting, I'm walking. I said, you okay? I said, yes. Then get the girl, I said, no, I'm going to the church with this man.
Isn't this wonderful? Isn't this wonderful? I stir up this answer. I certify it. I authenticate it with the blood of Jesus. Lord, you will use your son as you showed me and as you showed your handmaid in my wife. Father, the multitudes that you have assigned to his life, he will fulfill his destiny in bringing them into the kingdom of God. Father, when he comes into heaven, there will be a crowd that he will bring with him. In the name of Jesus, I stir up this kingdom unction. Hallelujah. That your words will be laden with power. When you speak, devils will go. When you speak, people will be healed in Jesus' name. And release a prophetic grace, an unction. Prophet to the nations. A prophet to the nations. Prophet to the nations. You'll be a prophet to kings. Prophets to presidents, governors, is happening now. A mantle is falling upon your life where you will go to different nations. They will summon you in the courtyard and bedchambers of kings, and you will speak words of life to them. It is happening right now in the name of Jesus. I see it happening right now all over the world in the name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. I see Afghanistan. Hallelujah. It's happening. God will send you all over the world in the name of Jesus. Dear brother. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for my friend and for my brother. I thank you, Father, for his zeal and for his heart of healing. Thank you, Father, for the explosive grace buried in him, the explosive anointing that is in his voice, that is in his belly. Father, I thank you that, Father, that when I lay hands on him, there will be a stirring up of these rivers. Father, these rivers will be released. He will go throughout the world. Hallelujah. Father, I unplug him and I loose him into his divine destiny. Father, he will fulfill your mandate upon his life, it will not fail. He will prevail. Father, I thank you that as I have laid hands on him, heaven is bearing record. I stir up these rivers, this explosive anointing. Yes, hallelujah. Glory be to God. It's happening. Amen. Major proceeds. Major proceeds. The same grace on Maurice Cerulu is on your life. My brother, some people think they have Maurice Cerulu's oil and anointing. You have it. Amen. Election is by grace. Amen. It's not the person close by, it's the person who follows. There was a simple follower of Jesus healing people. That ancient, that mantle, I see crowds, it's like a postcard, yeah, it's a crowds, that you will minister by yourself, an explosiveness in you, explosive anointing, hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, thank you Lord, for this wonderful destiny, thank you for making us part of this, thank you Father that you will send your son throughout this world, nothing will stop it. Nothing will stop it in Jesus' name. It is done. It is done. It is done. Hallelujah. I saw like a postcard, you know, but the platform is so huge. You know, like those major crusades, if you go on small platforms, they'll mess you up. It's a high platform. But you know, it's explosive. It's explosive. Hallelujah. Who else is coming? Yes. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you. Blessed be thy name. Hallelujah.